How are you?
Good.
Thank you for coming. Okay. All right, it's up. Can you all read that question up there?
Yes.
Does the book of Revelation have a central theme? I like what Pastor Meyer said this morning about the Bible being a reflection of the mind of God. How many of you agree with that? And if we believe that the Bible is the mind of God, then we should see some design in it. Case in point, the book of Revelation. On the surface, looks very complicated, but it's the most systematic, the most organized book in the Bible. I love the book of Revelation. So I would like to spend a couple of hours with you looking at this book, maybe from a slightly different perspective. I would like to take a look at the central theme of the book of Revelation. What do you think that is? Of course, yeah, Jesus Christ is the theme. But you don't see Jesus Christ, you know, on the surface. You have to dig really deep to find him. May I suggest right now that if we wanted to discover the central theme of Revelation, we have to go to the center of the book of Revelation. Eventually, every theme, everything that the book of Revelation talks about points to Jesus. We don't deny that. But listen, to find out what the central theme of the book of Revelation is, we need to go to the center of the book. Have you done some investigation? Where is the center of gravity of the book of Revelation? The center, literally the center of the book of Revelation. Here it is, folks. And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. Did you know that? Literally at the center of the book. How do I know that? You just have to count the number of verses before it and the number of verses after it. And it's it. That's it. That is the center of the book. Revelation 12:7-9 is literally at the heart of the book of Revelation. And that is by design, folks. That is by divine design. Somebody did the counting, and if I'm right, there are 198 verses before it and 201 verses after it. You could say approximately that there are 200 verses before it and 200 verses after it. That places the record of the great controversy that started in heaven at the very heart of the book of Revelation. Now, why would John place that episode at the center of his book? Any guesses? Let's take just a minute trying to figure out what might be the reason why the beginning of the great controversy is placed at the center of the book of Revelation. Yes?
He might not have known. He was just writing what he was being told.
That's possible. Anyone else? That's where the controversy really started. May I suggest to you this afternoon that the reason why it's at the very center of the book is because God wants to teach us something. What do you think God? To teach us that everything that happens in this world, even those that happen in our own personal lives, can be explained in the light of the great controversy that happened in heaven. You know that we are going through this struggle in our very personal lives too, aren't we? It's not just events taking place out there. This great controversy that started in heaven is happening right here in our own hearts. And we are either one on one side or the other side of the issue. Isn't that right? It is the theme by which the prophecies of Revelation needs to be investigated and studied. So whether we're looking at the seven churches, the seven seals, the seven trumpets, they're all in the light of the great controversy that began in heaven, folks. How many of you saw this picture before? Yeah, pretty common. It's just telling us that the war that began in heaven between Michael and his angels and Lucifer and his angels is the very core of the book of Revelation. So, I'd like to explore with you this afternoon, if you're patient enough with me, to take a fresh look. You that the points, the thoughts we will share this afternoon will be something new, something refreshing, and something very intriguing. If I can challenge your minds this afternoon to spend time with Revelation and go deep into it, I've done my job. This is an easy question. All of us should be able to answer it. What is the main issue in the great controversy between Michael, who is Jesus, and Satan? Yes. Worship. Power. Rulership. Isn't it also true that the law of God is the very issue in the great controversy? The law of God and everything you said, worship, control, fall into that. The law of God is the central issue in the great controversy. Now, why is that so? Satan hates the law of God because it is the token of God's supreme authority. He wants to be where God is, so he is in the business of trying to overthrow that law because it's standing in the way, isn't it? It is the sign that God is who he is. Sin is the transgression of the law. Is it not right? The soul that sinneth, it shall die. The wages of sin is death. Why does Satan hate the law of God? He hates the law of God because it condemns him as a lawbreaker and sentences him to the lake of fire. If Satan can get rid of that law, he doesn't need to go to the lake of fire, does he? That's exactly the point. That's why he hates the law for that very reason. So what does he do? He wars against it. This is a statement from Great Controversy 582. From the very beginning of the great controversy in heaven, it has been Satan's purpose to overthrow what? The law of God. It was to accomplish this that he entered upon his rebellion against the Creator, and though common Adventist stuff. I'm just sharing this with you because it's just to introduce our study this afternoon. But we should all be familiar with this already. So here we see that Satan's purpose is to overthrow the law of God. How do you think he does that? How can he overthrow something that will be eternal? The law of God is eternal, just as God is eternal. How do you overthrow something that will live forever? This is how he does it. Satan endeavors to make that make sense. Now, why would Satan be in the business of making people transgress the law of God? Yes, so that they will share the same fate that he has. What other reasons? I'm trying to get your attention so you don't fall asleep. I know I had a good lunch. Yes. So that he can say that God is not just. Perfect. So that he can say that God is unfair in requiring obedience to a law that cannot be kept in the first place. If Satan can prove that point, then what? Then he can say, then what we're trying to say? He could not be condemned to that, exactly. He could say, he could put forth the argument that you have no right, God, to throw me or anyone else like me into the lake of fire for disobeying a law that could not be kept in the first place. That would be foul play. Isn't that right? That's why this is where it boils down to. Satan causes men to transgress the law of God so that he can cast a shadow upon the character of God, and so that he will what? Escape the lake of fire. How does he do it? How does he cause men to transgress the law of God? By a work of deception. Trick or treat. He deceives us to cause us to transgress the law of God so that he can say, see, I told you, this law is unfair. This law is not wholly just and good. It cannot be kept. Aside from deception, what else does he do? By signs and wonders, he makes fire come down from heaven to deceive. You need to disobey the law of God. Is that right, folks? I'm trying to build up a case here. I'm trying to go slow and step by step, systematically. So we will Daniel 7:24 says, he shall cause this power that we all know about to change times and laws. What is that a reference to? The changing of times and laws, what is that a reference to? The Sabbath to the first day of the week. Why? What happens if people worship on the first day of the week instead of the seventh day of the week? They transgress the fourth commandment, and that plays very well into Satan's strategy to cause all men to transgress the law of God. And if he can't deceive us through false teachings or through miracles, what does he do? He will apply force. He will apply force. He will coerce you. Do not have the mark of the beast in the forehead or in the hand. Cannot buy or sell. Exactly. That's the whole point. All of this is part of Satan's plot to cause you and I to transgress the law of God, folks. Okay? I hope that is clear. Listen to this statement from Great Controversy 582 again. To deceive men aside the law altogether, or by rejecting one of its precepts, the result will be ultimately the same. He that offends in one point manifests contempt for the whole law. His influence and example are on the side of transgression. He becomes guilty of all. So if we break one of the commandments, we have broken all. So that's his modus operandi. If he can cause us to break one of these commandments, he's got us in the bag. Question for you. Who are those who will be deceived? Satan says he will deceive even the very elect. That's possible. But who will be deceived eventually? Those who do not love the truth are deceived, folks. Where do we read that? That's 2 Thessalonians 2, 8 to 12. How many of you here love the truth?
Amen.
The love of the truth is not something we develop. I do not love to wake up at 4 or 5 in the morning to study my Bible. It's not natural for me to study the Bible. That hunger and thirst for truth was given to me by God. The love of the truth is something, not something inherent in us. It is a gift that God gives to us if we hunger and thirst for it. How many of you are hungry and thirsting for truth? Especially truth for the time of the end.
Amen.
Know for sure that God is giving it to you according to the measure that you desire it. But if you don't have the desire for the love of the truth, He doesn't give it to us. And what happens? We are bound to be deceived by the deceiver of souls. He hopes to deceive even the very elect, so they too will transgress the law of God. Matthew 24, 24. How does He deceive the very elect? Laodicea. The very elect. How has He deceived Laodicea? Thou knowest not that thou art miserable, naked, wretched, poor, and blind, and you say, I am increased with goods and have need of nothing. Isn't that a deception?
Yeah.
To think that we are all right when we're not all right. So we need an eye salve to get out of that rut. 2 Thessalonians 2, 8 to 12. I won't read this to save time, but you know this. Those who do not receive the love of the truth will not be saved. They will believe a strong delusion, that they might be damned who believed not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. In seeking to cast contempt upon the divine statutes, Great Controversy 582, Satan has perverted what? The doctrines of the Bible, and errors have thus been incorporated into the faith of thousands who profess to believe the scriptures. Listen, folks, the last great conflict between truth and error is but the final struggle of the long-standing controversy concerning what? The law of God, folks. Upon this battle we are now entering in, a battle between the laws of men and the precepts of Jehovah, between the religion of the Bible and the religion of fable and tradition. Where are we now in the stream of time? She says, we are now entering into this battle, the battle between the laws of men, which cause you to transgress the law of God, and the law of God, which puts you and I at odds with the kings of the earth. This is what the final conflict is all about. Great Controversy 593. The great last delusion is soon to open before us. Antichrist is to perform his marvelous works in our sight. So closely will the counterfeit resemble the true that it will be impossible to distinguish between them except by what? The Holy Scriptures. By their testimony, every statement and every miracle must be tested. How well are we grounded in the Bible? Do you realize, don't you realize that the spirit of prophecy was given to us not to replace the Bible, but so that we can be more fully grounded in Scripture, folks? One of my trade secrets, before I study a topic in the Bible, and this is part of, you know, how to study the Bible for me personally, I would read volumes of spirit of prophecy statements first, before I go to the Bible. And then I would go to the Bible and study. The Bible study is a lot easier if you already have concepts stored in your minds from the spirit of prophecy. Because the spirit of prophecy was designed to amplify the Bible. The spirit of prophecy does not replace the Bible. It is to magnify and make more clear Scripture. Only those who have been diligent students of the Scriptures and who have received the love of the truth will be shielded from the powerful delusion that takes the world captive. It is so important, as Pastor Ivor Meyer said this morning, that we should be gathering what?
Bread.
bread, not only for us, but for others, because that is our only safety in the final conflict. Because in the final conflict, deceptions of all kinds will be all over us. And if we are not grounded in Scripture, we will fall for one of those deceptions. By the Bible testimony, these will detect the deceiver in his disguise. To all, the testing time will come. By the shifting of temptation, the genuine Christian will be revealed. What is Satan's objective in the great controversy? What is his objective? To cause us to transgress the law of God, as I said at the beginning, in order to support his bold claim that the law of God cannot be kept. I keep hammering this because this is vital in our study this afternoon. Success in this effort means he does not have to go where? To the lake of fire. He just has to prove that no one has ever kept the law of God. And then he does not have to go to the lake of fire. On the other hand, what is God trying to do in this controversy? God, on the other hand, is out to prove that his law is just, holy, and good, and can be kept, even by fallen, sinful men. Jesus came to this world not only to save us, but to show us how we can obey the law of God. Is it not right? He's not only our Savior, but our example in keeping God's law. How do we know God will succeed in this controversy? Not over yet, but how do we know that he will succeed? Revelation 14:12 says what? Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. These are people who are not keeping the commandments of God, you know, most of the time and once in a while lapsing into sin. These are people who are keeping the law of God perfectly by faith in Jesus. Isn't that right? Question is, are we going to be part of that group? What about those that Satan cannot deceive or coerce to transgress the law of God? What does he do with them? He tries to kill them, exactly. Satan tries to eliminate those he cannot deceive to transgress the law of God. Has he tried it to you yet? Satan persecutes and eliminates those who prove a lie, that his argument that the law of God cannot be kept is a lie. 2 Timothy 3:12 says, yea, all that will live, what kind of life? Godly life. What's another word for godly life? Commandment keeping. Those that keep the commandments of God and live godly lives will suffer what? Persecution. Because these people are proving a lie, Satan's claim that the law of God cannot be kept. Patriarchs and Prophets, page 77, bears that out very clearly. The holy life of Abel testified against Satan's claim that it is impossible for man to keep God's law. What was Abel's life? What was Abel's life? A testimony that God's law can be kept. So what did Satan do to him? He had Cain kill him. When Cain, moved by the spirit of the wicked one, saw that he could not control Abel, he was so enraged that he destroyed his life. And wherever there are any who will stand in vindication of the righteousness of the law of God, the same spirit will be manifested against them. So we go to Revelation 12. You see a long history of how Satan has been going after those who do not want to side with him in the great controversy. In Revelation 12, verse 4, Satan manifests his wrath on the man-child. Why was he mad with Jesus as soon as he was born? Because he was the Holy One. He kept his Father's commandments. Isn't that right? He would not deviate from the will of God. Even though obedience cost him much suffering, he obeyed anyway, and Satan hated him for that. In Revelation 12, 6, 13 to 16, Satan directs his wrath towards the church for how long? 1,260 years, for the same reason. And finally, the last verse of Revelation 12 says what? And the dragon was wroth with the woman, and the remnant of her seed who keep the commandments of God, who went to make war with the remnant of her seed who keep the commandments of God and have the what? The testimony of Jesus. It's a war between the dragon and those who keep the commandments of God. So the great controversy boils down to one thing. It is the struggle between those who keep the commandments of God by faith and those who transgress it. It is the battle between those who support Satan's claim that the law cannot be kept by living lives of disobedience and those who disprove that claim by living lives of faith and obedience. Which side of the controversy are we on? I hope this is easy enough even for the young people over there. E.G. White comments, volume 7, 97. This is a powerful statement. There are only two parties. How many? And it's not Republican or Democrats, folks. What is this? There are only two parties upon this earth, those who stand under the bloodstained banner of Jesus Christ and those who stand under the banner of, under the black banner of rebellion. In the 12th chapter is represented what? The great conflict between the obedient and who? The disobedient, folks. The obedient and the disobedient. Now, this is the fun part. The obedient and the disobedient are branded with special numbers to identify them and to highlight the characteristics they develop throughout the course of the great controversy. This is where we start putting on our thinking caps. I hope you're thinking. I like to give Bible studies that make people think, at least. What does God do? He brands the disobedient and the obedient with special numbers, not only to identify them, but to what? To highlight the characteristics they develop throughout the course of the great controversy. In other words, what God is doing is marking characters that are developed. Why? That shouldn't surprise you, because even the numbers of our hairs, even our hairs are numbered. So God brands the characteristics of the obedient and the disobedient to highlight not only their identity, but also their characteristics. The three beast powers of Revelation are the disobedient. Are you familiar with these three beast powers? The first one in Revelation 12. The red dragon with seven heads and 10 horns, isn't that right? And then we have the sea beast of Revelation 13, and what's the third beast? The false prophet, what beast is it? The beast coming out of the earth, isn't that right? So we have three beasts, the beast, the red dragon of Revelation 12, and then you have the sea beast, and then the earth beast of Revelation 13. Are you all familiar with this? We should be, right? Shouldn't be hard, good. These beasts they join forces either to deceive or coerce men to transgress the law of God. They join forces to cause men to transgress the law of God either by deception or by coercion. They are branded with what number, do you think? They are branded with the number 6 to identify them and to highlight their rebellious characteristics. I hope you're with me. Yes. Yes, the same threefold powers. Exactly the same threefold powers we heard this morning from Pastor Myers. They are branded with what number? 6. Have you heard of 666? Revelation 13. How many of you have done any kind of study on that? Okay. Good. Wonderful. I'm in the right crowd. So we're studying the same topic. The 144,000 are the obedient. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. What number do you think is branded on them? 7. Who said 7? I heard a lot of 7s. They are stamped with the number 7 to identify them and to highlight their godly characteristics. And why do you think God is highlighting characters? Why? Because in the great controversy, God is not so much interested in what we know about events and timelines. He's not so much interested in that, even though they're good. They're good stuff. What God is more interested in, folks, is what kind of characters we develop in the great controversy. So he highlights the characters that are good and the characteristics that are bad. So we know what to include in our character building. Does that make sense? I hope I'm making sense. This is the whole point of our study. And the wise are told to count. Where do we find that verse? Anybody? Where in Revelation 13 is the call to count? Revelation 13, verse 18. Isn't that right? Yes. So let's turn there. Here is wisdom. Let him that hath understanding count the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 666. Now here's my question for you. How are you going to interpret that number? How many, what do you think is the 666? What do you think it is? The number of the beast. What is it? Are we going to interpret this number literally or symbolically? Symbolically? Is 666 literally 666, or is it a spiritual entity that needs to be spiritually counted and discerned? What do you think? Spiritually? How many of you say spiritually? Raise your hand. I see some hands. How many of you say literally? Literally, okay? Listen, folks, if we make 666 literally 666, are you with me? This is what we get. And some of you are saying, right. What you're doing here is you're literally counting from a literal title of a literal man and position, literally counting numbers and literally coming up with 666. Because you're adding Vicarius Filii Dei, and all the Roman numerals you put together will come up with a literal 666. And this is what we've been doing. This is what you get if you interpret 666 literally. You are literally counting the letters of a literal title and coming up with a literal result, 666. What happens if we do that? What happens if we literally take 666 to mean 666? You are reading at the surface. Am I making sense? You are reading at the surface. And that creates serious troubles. Am I making sense? Here's why. If we do that, we need to take the other numbers in that chapter and the other numbers in the book of Revelation literally then, to be consistent. One thing I learned when I was in the seminary, when you are interpreting something, you have to be consistent. You can't mix oranges and apples. Am I making sense? So, if you take 666 to mean literally 666, then you have to take the 42 months. Remember, the sea beast was given 42 months to reign? Then that has to be literally 42 months now. Am I making sense? And the 144,000 in Revelation 7 would be literally 144,000 people. And the 1,260 days of Revelation 12 would literally mean what now? 1,260 days. Am I making sense, folks? Okay, great. That's not the worst part. Here's the worst part. The name Ellen G. White literally adds up to 666. How many of you did not know this? And you'll be surprised where I took this little graphic from a Catholic website. L is 50, and you have two of them in Ellen, and then V is 5, L is 50, D is 500, and then White, you have two V's, that's 10, And then you have the letter I is equal to 1, and you take that together and literally add it, you have literally 666. How do you deal with that? Am I making sense, folks? Here's the reason why we need to understand 666 symbolically, folks. And I hope you're staying with me. How many of you are excited now? Okay, good. Here's one reason. Revelation 13 is a highly symbolic chapter. Am I making sense? It's symbols from beginning to end. Let me show you. Not only that, the great controversy becomes, the study of the great controversy becomes more interesting, more fun, and you get a sharper focus when you look at 666 symbolically, folks. I believe this is what God designed that number to be taken as, symbolically. The study of the end time prophecies become intensely interesting. Suddenly things start jumping out of the page when you look at 666 symbolically. When you look at 666 symbolically, then you begin to find 666 also in the book of Daniel. That will be new to you, for a lot of you this afternoon. It was new to me too. We begin to realize that in the great controversy, God is more interested in the kind of characters we develop than in our knowledge about events and timelines. And this is possible only if you take 666 symbolically. And who will understand it? The wise. Let's not read from the surface. Here's the reason why I believe the number 666 should be taken symbolically. Revelation 13, again, is a highly symbolic number. The beast coming out of the sea with seven head and ten horns. Is that literal or symbolic? Symbolic. You all agree. What about the sea? Is that symbolic? Yes, it is. What about the 42 months where it was given to this beast to reign? What does 42 months translate into? 1,260 years. If you take that literally, you're not going anywhere. The lamb that was slain from the foundation of the world. Is that literal or symbolic? In verse 8. Symbolic, exactly. What about the beast coming out of the earth? In verse 11. That's also symbolic. What about the earth? That's symbolic. What about the fire that comes down from heaven? That's symbolic. Isn't that right? What about the image of the beast? That's symbolic. What about the mark or on the forehead or on the hand? Is that symbolic or literal? Therefore, the name of the beast and the number of that name must be taken symbolically, folks. If you take it symbolically, it's no longer literally 666, but something else, as you will see. Okay? What does name signify symbolically in the Bible? Character, isn't that right? Exodus 33:19 says, and he said, I will make my goodness pass before thee, I will proclaim the name of the Lord before thee, and I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and show mercy on whom I will show mercy. And the next verses describe the character of God, listed sevenfold. The perfect character of God is listed by Moses in this chapter in a sevenfold fashion. The great controversy comes into sharper focus when the number of his name, 666, is taken symbolically. Things we never saw before suddenly come to view. The study of the prophecy suddenly becomes interesting. So, are you ready to count? What does it mean to count again? The call to count the number of the name, spiritually, has very little to do with literally adding up numbers of letters from a name or a title of a person, because that would be taking it literally and it's reading from the surface. Rather, it is a call to count spiritually, to be cognizant of characteristics that are being brought to light by the divine author. It is to study these characteristics, folks. Do you understand what I'm saying? To count means to do what now? To study these characteristics. Because we don't want to develop the wrong character. So, the red dragon of Revelation 12 is branded with the number 6. Why? Because it does 6 things. Either to deceive or to intimidate men to transgress the law of God in Revelation 12, folks. How many of you have seen this? This red dragon is associated with the number 6 because it does exactly 6 things in the book of Revelation, either to deceive or to intimidate men to transgress the law of God. I wish I had time. I could break you up into small groups like Pastor Ivermeyer does and give you an assignment and let you find these 6 things in Revelation 12, but I don't have time right now. So I'm just going to give this to you. Are you ready to count? The first one is in verse 4. His tail drew the third part of the stars of heaven and cast them on the earth. You can verify this in your Bible. You can highlight your Bible and verify that this is true when you get home. The second one is in verse 4. He stood before the woman to devour the child as soon as it was born. Number 3, the dragon and his angels fought against Michael and his angels. Revelation 12, verse 7. Verse 13, he persecuted the woman which brought forth the man-child. These are all what kind of actions? Rebellious actions. Either causing men to transgress the law of God or persecuting those who are keeping the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Number 5, the serpent cast out of his mouth water as a flood to carry the woman away in the flood. Are you following along? And the last one is in the last verse. The dragon went forth to make war with a remnant of her seed. 6 things, folks. What is God doing here? God is marking the rebellious activities of this power, not only to identify it as the enemy, but to highlight its rebellious characteristics. Do you see what I'm saying? You see this only if you take that number symbolically. The second beast, the beast coming out of the sea, is stamped with the number 6 because it is described in Revelation 13 as receiving 6 things, folks. This is amazing. I don't believe this is random. I don't believe this is coincidence. I don't believe that this is just happenstance. I believe this is by design, divine design. Are you ready to count with me? The beast rising out of the sea, Revelation 13. The dragon gave him his power and great authority. Do you see that? This is assuming you already read this chapter and the verses are not new to you. The second one, it was given unto him a mouth speaking great things. The third one, power was given him to continue how many months? 42 months, prophetic. Number 4, it was given him to make war with the saints. Number 5, power was given him over kindred and tongues and nations. And number 6, life given to the beast when the image of the beast is formed. That's verse 15. The reason why the image of the beast is formed is to give life to that beast who had a deadly wound, folks. You're all familiar with that, right? Yes. So I won't spend too much time on that. So how many beasts do we have now? 2. The third one, the earth beast. The beast with the lamb-like horns is also stamped with the number 6. Why? Because it does exactly 6 things in Revelation 13. Either to deceive men to transgress the law of God or to persecute those who keep it. Are you ready to count with me? The first one, verse 12. He exercises all the power of the first beast. Number 2, he causes men to worship the first beast. Number 3, he performs great wonders and miracles to deceive them that dwell on the earth. Number 4, he makes an image to the beast. Number 5, he causes that as many as will not worship the image of the beast to be what? Killed. And number 6, he causes all to receive the mark of the beast in the forehead or in the hand. Isn't that amazing, folks? Isn't this amazing? Revelation 12, Revelation 13, all the three beasts. This is amazing. I don't know if you see divine design in here. This is really amazing. Yes. In contrast, the obedient in the great controversy are stamped with a number 7. That's really amazing. The 7 things are mentioned about the 144,000 in Revelation 14. How many of you knew this before? How many of you are hearing this for the first time? Let's count again. We are counting what now? Characteristics. We are counting spiritually. We are being made cognizant of characteristics that make up the experience of the obedient. Number 1, they stand with the Lamb on Mount Zion, having the Father's name on their foreheads. Number 2, they have harps and sing a new song before the throne and before the four beasts and the elders. That's verses 2 and 3. Number 3, they are redeemed from the earth. That's verse 3. Number 4, they are not defiled with women, for they are virgins. That's verse 4. Number 5, they follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. They are obedient people. Number 6, they are redeemed from among men, being first fruits unto God and to the Lamb. And number 7, in their mouth was found no guile, for they are without fault before the throne of God. 7 things, folks. Not 6, not 5, but 7. Tell me if this is not amazing. This is really amazing. And this is just scratching the surface, folks. I hope I have time to finish this today. This is just scratching the surface. I may just have to get rid of the 10-minute break. Is that okay? Because we started really late. And I'm supposed to end 10 minutes before the time anyway. So is that okay? Okay. Thank you so much for your patience. In Revelation 19, Christ's physical appearance is rendered in a sevenfold fashion at his second coming. Why am I including Jesus here? Because Jesus, even though he were a son, what did he do? He learned obedience by the things he had suffered. Isn't that right? He was obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. So, 7 things are said about Christ's physical appearance when he comes again the second time. Are you ready to count with me? His eyes were as a flame of fire. On his head were many crowns. He had a name written that no man knew but he himself. Number 4, he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood. Number 5, his name is called the Word of God. Number 6, out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron. Number 7, he hath on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings, Lord of Lords. 7 things. To summarize, the great controversy that started in heaven is between 2 classes of people, the obedient and the disobedient, over what now? The law of God. Both groups develop opposite characters throughout the course of the controversy. And as I said, the most important thing about the great controversy is not so much knowing about events and timelines and horns and crowns and beasts, but developing the right character and being on the right side of the issue. Does that make sense? That is why we have these numbers. God does not only number our hairs, he numbers our characteristics. That's an amazing God. These character traits are stamped with special numbers to highlight them. We'll skip the break. We'll just move on. Part 2. We were supposed to have a break there, but you made a deal with me, right? Okay. So, how did I learn these truths, folks? How did I learn this? Are you interested in... no one's asking, how did you learn this?
Pastor Sean.
Yes.
How did you learn this?
Yeah.
All the stuff that... How did you How did you figure that out?
Okay. First of all, I got hold of a statement. This statement gave me some kind of a basis for making my own Bible studies. Here it says, the Lord has made his people the depositaries of sacred truth. He has set them on an elevated position above the world. He declares of them, you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that you should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. And again, he says, ye are the light of the world, a city that is set on a hill that cannot be hid. What are we?
Light of the world.
Light of the world. We are the depositaries of sacred truth, and we should be like light, like a lamp set on a hill, brightening everything around us. Listen, upon every individual who has had the light of present truth devolves the duty of developing that truth on a higher scale than it has hitherto been developed. I took this seriously, and what I did was study and then build on it, add to it until it's my own, it's original. You see what I'm saying? Because I read this and say, it's our duty to do this. It's our duty not only to study the Bible and learn what others already know in the first place, but to take that which is known, add to it our own ideas and thoughts, our own discoveries, so that it becomes new light, folks. This is what I did. This is what I did. The Lord will hold us accountable for the influence we might have exerted and did not, because we did not earnestly try to understand our accountability in this world. Our accountability is not only to understand truth, but to build it in a way that it becomes no longer the same as the original, but something much better. How many of you understand what is she saying here? It is that it's a duty for us to do this. So I understand this, but how did I build on what is known? What I just shared with you, I did not read from a book, folks. I don't know if there's any book out there that talks about this. Maybe, I don't know, I've never seen it. What I did, what I took, what I've read from other books, and then studied the Bible. In Daniel 12, verse 10, we are told that in the time of the end, when truth is unsealed, many will understand. Many will understand. The wise will understand. How will the wise understand? Is there a methodology? Do I have to go to the seminary? How did I arrive at this truth, folks? The book of Daniel tells us how. In Daniel 9, what was Daniel doing in Daniel 9? He had the book of Jeremiah open, isn't that right? He was trying to study the 2,300-day prophecy. He didn't understand it. And so he went to Jeremiah, where we read about the 70 weeks. And what else was he doing? He was praying, he was fasting, he was wearing sackcloth, and he was making confession, not only of his sin, but the sins of his people. That was 12 years after he received light on the 2,300-day prophecy in Daniel 8. It took some time. When he was in this attitude of study and prayer and fasting, the angel Gabriel was sent to explain to him what he did not understand in Daniel 8, folks. I confess to you, I can tell you honestly, this is what happened to me. I'm not a morning person, but I decided to wake up early in the morning, 4 or 5 in the morning, which I don't normally do. I know some of you may wake up even earlier than that, but for me that was difficult. But I did it because I wanted to study the Bible. And so I would pray and open my Bible and study every day early in the morning. And as I'm in that attitude, the Lord convicted me of my sins. You know what I'm saying? The sins of my past life. He convicted me so hard. that I couldn't study anymore. I would just roll on the floor and cry and cry and cry. And then the light would come. God would send me light on these things. Impressions would come to my mind. You know what I'm saying? How many of you understand what I'm saying? I began to realize that the only way we can truly understand truth, there's no human methodology. I mean, they can only go up a certain point. But if you want to understand the truth of the time of the end, you have to go through the Day of Atonement's all affliction experience. And this went on and on for a long time. And this is how I developed the sanctuary service message, the great controversy, righteousness by faith, all in the context of the time of the end. Today, I'm still going through that. How many of you want to try that now? Ask the Lord to convict you of your sin. And you don't have to worry about how am I going to study. This thing is so difficult. I believe an angel will be at your side to guide you into all truth if you will only confess your sin to him. Give it a try. I'm speaking from my own experience. Yours may be different. This is the path that God took me in understanding truth, going to the soul affliction that you read about in Daniel 9. It's right there. So in the time of the end, the many will understand, the wise will understand, and the wise are those who are going to the Day of Atonement, soul affliction. Why are we studying the symbolic numbers again? The book of Revelation assigns number to represent two classes of people who develop opposite characters throughout the great controversy. Hence, there is a call to count, to study these characteristics to those who are wise. Are you wise? Are you counting spiritually? The branding of the three beast powers of Revelation with the number 6 ties them to the three powers in the book of Daniel who are also disobedient and branded with the number 6. Did you just catch that? The powers, the three powers of Revelation are branded with the number 6. So they will be tied to the three powers in Daniel who are also disobedient and are branded with the number 6. This tie-in between these powers need to be clearly understood and seen to better understand the issues that will play out in the climax of the great controversies, in the great controversy. The issues that you read about in Daniel will be repeated in our time. And God teaches us that by branding these powers in Daniel and Revelation with the same number, the number 6. Are you ready to count? Yes? Are you ready to count? Yes? I won't, if you don't say yes. The two Babylonian monarchs, Nebuchadnezzar and Belshazzar, are stamped with the number 6. To give you a little heads up, Babylon, Medo-Persia, and the Roman little horn power are all branded with the number 6. These three powers are branded with the number 6. The Medes and the Persians are also stamped with the number 6. The Roman little horn power of Daniel 7 is also branded with the number 6. Daniel 3, Babylon's worship and music stamped with a number 6. How do we know that? The image of gold, which was the object of worship, the dimensions of this image are factors of the number 6. 60 by 6. That's not so exciting, but it's there. 6 specific musical instruments connected with worship are mentioned 3 times by name in Daniel chapter 3, verse 5, verse 10, and verse 15. Cornet, flute, harp, sackbut, psaltery, and dulcimer. 6. Does that mean Babylon only has 6 musical instruments? No. But 6 are highlighted to stamp their music with the number 6. The call to worship the image that Nebuchadnezzar had set up is mentioned how many times, do you think? 6 times in Daniel 3, folks. Verse 5, verse 10, verse 7, verse 12, verse 14. Verse 18, 6 times. Is that by chance? I don't think so. Likewise, in Revelation, the worship of the beast is mentioned. How many do you think? 6 times. Listen, if this is only happening once or twice or 3 times, maybe there's nothing to it, right? But if it keeps reoccurring in a consistent fashion, there is some design to it, right? To say the least. to say the least. There is a pattern that is clearly evident in what Daniel and John are doing. In contrast, if you read Psalms 150, there is a sevenfold list of musical instruments connected with the worship in the sanctuary. That's amazing. Not six, not five, seven. Trumpet, psaltery, harp, timbrel, stringed instruments, organs, and cymbals. Seven. That's amazing. The most exciting part is this. Nebuchadnezzar does six things in Daniel 3 to coerce his subjects to transgress the law of God and to intimidate those who keep it. Yes. Perfection. Imperfection. We will go there. We will prove it from the Bible. Nebuchadnezzar does six things in Daniel 3 to coerce his subjects to transgress the law of God and to intimidate those who keep it. Are you ready to count?
Yes.
Okay. The king made an image of gold whose height was 70 cubits. Verse 1. Why is this rebellious, folks? What's wrong with making an image of gold? Why did God stamp that with the number 6? Yes?
Worship.
What's wrong with worship? That's the way they worship. Why is this rebellious? Let's hear some more thoughts. Yes? Do not make a graven image. Connect this with Daniel 2. What did God reveal to Nebuchadnezzar in Daniel 2? Through Daniel. Yes? Yes, he had a dream with an image, but was that image all of solid gold? No. That image was made of gold, silver, bronze, and iron and clay. Isn't that right? What statement was Nebuchadnezzar saying or making in Daniel 3? By making that golden image. Yes? He did not agree with God, right? No. You are saying an inferior kingdom will come after me? No way. My kingdom will last forever. So he builds that image made of solid gold, folks, in rebellion against God's revealed will. Number 2, the king gathered together the princes, the governors, and captains. What's wrong with this? It's just gathering them. It was the purpose of forcing these people to what? To worship and transgress the law of God, who says you should not bow down before what? An idol and things like that. Number 3, he commanded the people to fall down and worship the golden image that the king had set up. That's in verses 4 and 5. Number 4, Nebuchadnezzar commanded to bring Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to warn them to bow down to the image or be thrown in the fiery furnace. Bring them over to me, because they would not listen. And then he warns them. This is the fourth rebellious thing he does. What is he doing here? He is forcing these three Hebrew worthies to transgress the law of God. Notice the issue keeps playing out. I want you to transgress the law of God, either by deception or by what? By force, exactly. Are you beginning to see the great controversy in a different light? Yes? Yes, that's wonderful. Number 5, he commanded that they should heat the furnace 7 times more. Number 6, he commanded the most mighty men in his army to bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and cast them in the burning furnace. 6 things, folks. Tell me if this is coincidence again. Tell me if this is coincidence or random or chance. I don't think so. In Daniel 5, the gods of Babylon are stamped with the number 6. How many of you had read Daniel 5? I'm sure all of you read Daniel 5 at least 5 times. 6 Babylonian gods are mentioned in connection with Belshazzar's call to idolatrous worship. You find it in Daniel 5, verse 4 and 23. 6 gods. Did Babylon only have 6 gods? The gods of silver, of gold, bronze, iron, wood, and stone. 6 Babylonian gods are stamped with the number 6 to highlight Babylon's rebellion. But that's not the most exciting part. The most exciting part is this. Daniel gives 6 reasons. How many? 6 reasons why Belshazzar is weighed in the balance and found wanting. I never saw this before. I was in the seminary. I had a class in Daniel in the undergraduate level and another class in the graduate level. I never saw this. I never saw this. Here's what it is. Number one, that's in verse 22. That's Daniel 5, verse 22. Thou hast not humbled thine heart, though you knew all this. Thou hast lifted up thyself against the Lord of heaven. That's number two, verse 23. And have brought the vessels of his house before thee. Number four. Thou and thy lords have drunk wine in them. You notice these are all rebellious actions. Number five. Thou hast praised the gods of gold and silver, of brass, iron, wood, and stone. Here he reverses the gold and the silver. Is there any significance to that, you think? What? Yes, because Babylon would be on its way out and there would be a new kid in town, right? There would be a new power. Medo-Persia, the Silver Kingdom, would be coming up soon. And number six, God in whose hands thy breath is, thou hast not glorified. Six things. Six reasons. So Belshazzar and Nebuchadnezzar are both stamped with the number six. And here's what's even more amazing. Six reasons are given in Revelation 18 why Babylon is fallen. Isn't that amazing? We're jumping from Daniel to Revelation and looking at all the parallels. Isn't the Word of God wonderful? Do you see how beautiful inspiration is? You see design in here? God is amazing. This teaches me that God is not taken by surprise. He even makes wordplay. You know, the whole great controversy thing is play for God. He just assigns numbers. He knows the end from the beginning. This assures me that God's people will triumph in the end because he understands everything about the great controversy. He knows who he is contending with. He numbers their characteristics. That's amazing. Here's the six reasons we find in Revelation 18. Number one, 18 verse 2 of Revelation. She is become the habitation of devils. Number 2. She is the hold of every foul spirit. Number 3. She has become the cage of every unclean and hateful bird. Number 4. All nations have drunk of the wrath of her fornication. Number 5. The kings of the earth have committed how many? I'm sorry? The kings of the earth have committed what? Fornication with her, that's verse 3 and number 6. The merchants of the earth are waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacies. I don't believe this is random. It cannot be random. Going back to Daniel, to the Medes and the Persians. The Medes and the Persians are stamped with the number 6 because they do what now? They do 6 things to try to eliminate the commandment-keeping Daniel. Can you imagine that? If you still haven't gotten the idea, I hope you get it by now. The presidents and the princes sought to find occasion against Daniel concerning the kingdom. That's number one. It's found in verses 4 and 5. What are they doing? What evil characteristic are they manifesting here? What evil characteristic is being highlighted here? How about envy, jealousy, bitterness, hatred, isn't it right? Strife. Number two, the presidents and princes assembled together to petition King Darius to establish a royal decree, a firm decree regulating prayer for 30 days. Is that rebellious? Absolutely. Number three, verse 8 to 9. These men urged the king to sign the writing that it cannot be changed, according to the law of the Medes and the Persians. Number four, these men assembled to find Daniel praying and making supplication before his God. What are they doing here now? They're finding fault. They're setting a trap for the commandment-keeping Daniel. And number five, they compel the king to execute the decree because the law of the Medes and the Persians does not change. After they find Daniel praying to his God, with his windows open to Jerusalem, they quickly report to the king and says, now you have to execute the decree. That's the trap is sprung, right? Number six, King Darius commands that Daniel be cast in the lion's den. Six, rebellious actions. The third power in Daniel is the Roman little horn power. Six things are said about this power in Daniel 7. Have you seen this before? No? Yes, now you will see it. Number one, he shall be diverse from the first. He shall subdue three kings. Are these familiar expressions? Yeah. Yeah? Are things beginning to ring in your ears? Or bells, you know, start ringing in your ears? Number three, he shall speak great words against the Most High. Number four, he shall wear out the saints of the Most High. Number five, he shall think to change times and laws. Number six, they shall be given into his hand until a time, times, and a dividing of time. Six. Wow. Am I the only one excited here? God is good. God is really good. And it's, you know, it's deep, but it's simple. It's deep, but it's simple. So what are we learning right now? Nebuchadnezzar is tempted. I hope you're paying attention. This is the application of what we have discovered so far. Is stamped with the number six to highlight his efforts in compelling men to transgress the law of God, folks. Bow down and worship. Which part of the Ten Commandments deal with worship? Which part of the Ten Commandments deal with worship? The fourth one, that's right, the Sabbath. Will there be another golden image in our time? Yes, will there be another effort to compel men to bow down and worship today? Yes, but instead of an image, what will we have? A law, that's right, a law. So Nebuchadnezzar has to do with causing men to transgress the law of God, and Belshazzar is stamped with the number six to highlight his attack on what? The sanctuary. Are you beginning to see some light here? There is so much more to what Belshazzar did when he took those vessels and drinking, putting wine in them and drinking in them than just profaning the sanctuary. There's a whole theology behind it. What does he represent? Attack on the sanctuary. Is that happening today? Yes, it's happening today, folks. There's so much more I can say about that, but the little horn power of Daniel 7 causes men to transgress the law of God by attempting to change times and laws and persecuting those who keep God's commandments for a time, times, and the dividing of time. The Medes and the Persians intimidate Daniel, who represents those who worship in the sanctuary. How do we know that Daniel represents the sanctuary? Because when he prayed, he had his windows open towards where? Jerusalem. And what was in Jerusalem that he was praying to? The sanctuary, that's right. So here again, we have the law of God and the sanctuary. Do you see this? Do you understand now why God is stamping these with number six? So that when we hit Revelation, we are not surprised. The issues in Revelation are the same issues that we already read about in Daniel 3 all the way to Daniel 7. Controversy over the law of God and the sanctuary, folks. Am I making sense? Is this making sense to you? It becomes clear then that the issues that will play out in the final conflict will be over the law of God and the sanctuary. Yes? You see it clearly now? Without the number six, we will not see the tie-in between Daniel and Revelation. Between the beast powers there and the beast powers of Revelation. And between the issues that were playing out in Daniel and the issues that will play out in our time. They're just a replay. A replay, folks. God does not want us to be caught by surprise. He wants us to be ready for these issues. That's why he is teaching us these things. You would not have been able to see this if you stuck with the idea that 666 was a literal number. All you would have gotten is, Vicaris Filii Dei, that's it. That's what I believed for a long time. When I was in the seminary, that's what I believed, and that's it. I hit a blank wall right after that when I studied Revelation because there was nothing more to discover. If the number six is literal, that's it. nothing else to learn. I'm amazed at what God does to teach us. The three beast powers of Revelation are stamped with the number 6 to teach us that these merely follow in the footsteps of Babylon, Medo-Persia, and Rome in trampling the rights of conscience and inducing people to transgress the law of God. I hope you see it by now. The conflicts recorded in Revelation are nothing but what now? Replays of old controversies portrayed in the book of Daniel over what? The law and the sanctuary. In other words, the law and the gospel, folks. The law and the gospel. The sanctuary is the gospel. And the final conflict recorded in Revelation 12:17 is nothing but the culmination of that long controversy over the law of God and the sanctuary. In other words, the law and the gospel, as I said. Here in Manuscript Release, Volume 14, page 92, Ellen White tells us that just like there was a golden image in the time of Daniel, in Daniel 3, in the plains of Dura, there will be another image set up today where men will be forced to bow down and worship to in transgression or in violation of the law of God. She says, an idol Sabbath has been set up as the golden image was set up in the plains of Dura. And as Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, issued a decree that all who would not bow down and worship the image should be killed, so a proclamation, what now, folks? A proclamation will be made that all who will not reverence the Sunday institution will be punished with imprisonment and death. Thus, the Sabbath of the Lord is trampled underfoot. This should not anymore catch us by surprise, because we saw this in Daniel 3, and it's just going to be replayed. Are you ready for this? If you have the character that what God designs that you and I should have, we should not be unprepared. We have a high priest who will give us this character, folks. It's a free gift, courtesy of the final atonement. How many of you believe that? The corrupt harlot of Revelation 6:17 is stamped with the number 6. Who is this harlot of Revelation 17? It's spiritual Babylon, except this time the events listed in Revelation 17 take place after the wound has healed, folks, the time that we are living in. So here is a sixfold list of the things that belong to this woman. Number 1, she sits upon a scarlet-colored beast, which has 7 heads and 10 horns, full of names of blasphemy. That's verse 3. The second one, the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet. Third one, she's decked with precious gold, and she is decked with gold and precious stones and pearls. She has a golden cup in her hand, full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. Number 5, upon her forehead was written, Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. And number 6, the woman was drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. Yes. It's in the healing process. More 6s. The name Babylon is found 6 times in Revelation. Did you know that? 6 exact times. Not 5, not 7. 6 times. And I've given you the references. In fact, I'm going to ask you, your assignment is to find these 6 instances in Revelation, the whole book of Revelation, where you find the name Babylon. Spiritual Babylon's attire has 6 components: fine linen, purple, scarlet, gold, precious stones, and pearls. Spiritual Babylon is destroyed in the 6th plague. Can you imagine that? Even her destruction is numbered. Babylon falls when? During the 6th plague, when the river Euphrates is dried up, folks. In other words, when earthly support is withdrawn from her. That's amazing. 6 things are said to be found no more in Revelation 18, when Babylon falls and is found no more. There are no more. There are 6 things that are found no more. Back in Revelation 17, the word woman, remember that harlot we talked about in Revelation 17? Yes? The word woman is found 6 times also in Revelation 17. That's amazing. I want you to look it up, you know, see if you can verify that. When Babylon is destroyed, Revelation 19, there are six kinds of flesh eaten by the fowls of the air in the supper of the great God. Would you like to know what these are? The flesh of kings, the flesh of captains, the flesh of mighty men, the flesh of horses, of them that sit on them, the flesh of all men, both free and bond, both small and great, folks. Six. This is amazing. I don't know about you. Yeah. What happened was, when I was reading Revelation 13, I found out that six things were given to Babylon, all right? Six things were given to Babylon, or to the sea beast. Then I asked myself, could it be that this is a pattern that is repeated in the Bible? So I looked at Revelation 12, and sure enough, there were six things said there too. And then I went back to Revelation 13, and could this also be true of the earth beast? And sure enough, there were six things. And I constantly got impressions looking at the book of Daniel too. So I went to Daniel and started counting there, and I found all these sixes right there. Keep asking questions. The number six goes all the way back to Cain. Nebuchadnezzar, the Medes and the Persians, they're not the first ones stamped with the number six. Cain is stamped with the number six in Genesis 4 to highlight his rebellious characteristics. The first one, Cain brought the fruit of the ground. What's so bad about this? What's rebellious about this? What did God require? A bloody sacrifice, right? This meant that he did not trust in the death of Christ. Isn't that right? That he could save himself with a bloodless sacrifice. So that was rebellious. Number two, Cain was very wroth and his countenance fell. Why was he angry? Because Abel was not on his side. Abel kept the commandments of God and he did not. Number three, Cain talked with Abel and Cain rose up against his brother Abel to slew him. Murder, folks. Number four, and Cain said, I know not. Am I my brother's keeper? What's so rebellious about this? What's that? It's a lie, and what else? Am I my brother's keeper? Yes. What's the attitude behind this? I don't care. Number five, Cain said unto the Lord, my punishment is greater than I can bear. Self-pity. Unfair, God. You are unfair. Isn't that right? Yes? You're not treating me right. This is too much punishment you're giving me. And number six, the most serious part. And Cain went out from the presence of the Lord. Six things. You see the pattern? And then we go back all the way to Lucifer. Yes. The mark of Cain? I don't know. It may be, huh? Maybe. Six. Maybe. It may also have been a physical mark. I can't tell you for sure. The Bible doesn't say. The branding of the number six goes all the way back to Lucifer, folks. He is the root of the number six. And here, we will find out why six is the number of rebellion. We will find out in this point right here. The Bible gives a sixfold account of Lucifer's sin and rebellion in heaven. Where do we find that? Ezekiel 28. Iniquity was found in thee. This is the first one. 28 verse 15. By the multitude of thy merchandise, they have filled the midst of thee with violence. This is number two. Number three, thou hast what? Sinned. Number four, thine heart was lifted up because of thy beauty. Wow, what is this? Pride. You know what God is doing here? He is marking, again, I keep saying this to you because this is a new concept. He is marking characteristics that we need to study and be cognizant of because we don't want this in our character building. Number five, thou hast corrupted thy wisdom by reason of thy brightness. And number six, thou hast defiled thy sanctuaries by the multitude of thine iniquities and by the iniquity of thy traffic. Sixfold description of the fall of Lucifer. Wow. You see how the prophets are all in agreement? John, Daniel, Ezekiel. This is amazing. This is amazing. And now, the rationale for the number six. Why six? Why? The reason why Lucifer is stamped with the number six is clearly given in Ezekiel 28, verse 15 and verse 12. Thou wast perfect in all thy ways until what? Until iniquity was found in thee. Seven is the number of perfection. In fact, there's an Ellen White quote in Christ Object Lesson somewhere that says that seven is the number of perfection. You can look it up also. Christ Object Lesson. In other words, Lucifer went from a seven to a less than seven, from perfection to imperfection. So you see that the number six is what mark now? Is the mark of imperfection. Those who will remain filthy forever. Am I making sense? Yes, the disobedient, the rebellious. Perfect in beauty until corrupted by wisdom. Do you see the theology behind the number six now? Thou wast perfect in all thy ways until iniquity was found in thee. Lucifer went from perfection, symbolized by the number seven, to imperfection, symbolized by the number six, which is less than seven, as a result of his pride, his ambition, his desire to claim divine prerogatives. You get it? I'm going fast because I'm running out of time. On the other hand, folks, what is going to happen to God's people who are defective now and imperfect? What is going to happen to them? God's commandment people, on the other hand, will go from where? From imperfection to perfection. How many of you believe that with all your heart? Isn't that why we became Seventh-day Adventists? Because we believe that God is needing a people who he can point to and say, here are they that keep my commandments and the faith of Jesus. Yes. How will this happen? Volume 1 of the Testimony, 608-609. In the last vision given me, I was shown the startling fact. What kind of fact? Startling fact that but a small portion of those who now profess the truth will be sanctified by it and be saved. This is a scary statement. What does it say about the majority of Seventh-day Adventists? I hate to say this. I say this with fear and trembling, but this is not even my words. But what is she saying? The majority of us, of those who profess the truth, will not be sanctified and be saved. Many will get above the simplicity of the work. They will conform to the world, cherish idols, and become spiritually dead. The humble, self-sacrificing followers of Jesus will pass on to what? To perfection, folks. The humble, self-sacrificing followers of Jesus will pass on to perfection, leaving behind the indifferent and the lovers of the world. The question is, which group will you and I be found? Are we going to be deceived? Do we have areas in our lives where we are still being deceived into transgressing the law of God? We need to examine ourselves to see which group, which side of the controversy we are on. In Daniel 12, we are said that in the time of the end, go thy way, Daniel, for the words are closed up and sealed until the time of the end. Many shall be purified and made white and tried, but the wicked shall do wickedly, and none of the wicked shall understand, but the wise will understand. Are you beginning to be part of the wise now who are understanding a little bit better than we used to understand before? So the many who will be purified and made white are the ones that Ellen White was saying will be perfect, who will pass on from imperfection to perfection. And how is this going to be achieved? You still remember our study on the sanctuary? This is a benefit of the sanctuary service. What God requires, He Himself remembers, provides. God requires perfection, He Himself would provide it. will provide it through the work of Christ in the heavenly sanctuary. How many of you believe that? How many of you believe that before Jesus leaves the most holy place, he will make sure we are equipped for the final conflict, that we are reflecting his image? It doesn't matter what sin we have right now. If we are willing, if we are obedient, God will make it happen. I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, so that you may see. I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear. This is the white raiment we are being told to buy. And when are we going to buy this? When are we going to buy this? When we can no longer buy or sell. In the closing scenes of the great day of atonement, when God's people learn to afflict their souls and plead for purity of heart, then what happens? The great high priest says what? Take away their filthy garments and give them a change of raiment. Behold, I have caused your iniquity to pass from thee, and I have given you a change of raiment. The spotless robe of Christ's righteousness is placed upon the tried, tempted, faithful children of God. And since then, from that time on, they are never more to be defiled by the corruptions of the world, and they are eternally secure from the tempter's devices. Do you remember these statements from prophets and kings? It was only yesterday that you heard of them. Okay. The final destruction of the wicked, folks. The final destruction of the wicked after the millennium is also portrayed in a sixfold manner. So the number six goes all the way to the end. Are you tired of counting? Tired of writing? Wow, it's all over the book of Revelation and Daniel. What's this infatuation with the number six? Why is John consistently marking things, and Daniel too for that matter, with the number six? They want us to be aware of characteristics. Are you ready? Revelation 20. Satan is loosed out of prison. That's verse 7. Number 2, he goes out to deceive the nations again, which are in the four quarters of the earth, Gog and Magog. That's verse 8. He gathers them together to battle, the number of whom is as the what? The sand of the sea. These are familiar passages. Number 4, and they went up on the breadth of the earth and compassed the saints about the beloved city. Verse 9. Number 5, fire comes down from God out of heaven and devours them. And number 6, and the devil that deceived them was cast in the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, to be tormented day and night forever. How many? 6. Isn't the Bible scientific? It's very consistent. There is no randomness at all. Divine design is consistent. You think John could have come up with this on his own? There's no way. Not even Daniel. But here's the question. This is the most important part now of our study. The question is, which side of the great controversy are we on? That's all that matters really, doesn't it? Which side of the controversy are we on? What will determine which side of the controversy we are on? You just have to look back at the issues. What is the issue again? The law of God and the sanctuary, right? The law of God and the sanctuary. Your position and my position on the law of God and the sanctuary determines which side of the controversy we are on. Does that make sense? Because we found out that these are the issues that we saw back in the book of Daniel that were specially controverted. Nebuchadnezzar has to do with coercing people to transgress the law of God, and Belshazzar has to do with the attack on the sanctuary. So if we say that we can never keep the law of God, I hope I'm not stepping on anyone's toes here. If we say that we can never keep the law of God, that we will continue sinning until the cows go home, where are we? Which side are we on in the great controversy? We are on the wrong side, folks. Do you see how this clearly marks it out? Yes, if we say that our humanity is so depraved, we shouldn't even be talking about character perfection. We should not even be touching this point with a 10-foot pole, because we are so sinful, there is no way God can fix our sin problem except forgive us and forgive us and forgive us some more until you get tired of it. Which side of the great controversy are we on if we say that? Yes? If we say that everything was done at the cross, that what Jesus does in the heavenly sanctuary doesn't matter. It's redundant, it's irrelevant. Everything we need for salvation has been accomplished for us at Calvary. I hear this so many times. Which side of the controversy have we placed ourselves on by saying that? The wrong side, folks. I'm sorry to tell you this, but it's time to wake up. If we say that there is no sanctuary in heaven, if we marginalize the sanctuary and relegate it to the Adventist attic and say this is no longer relevant, this museum piece, what have we just done to the sanctuary? We have done nothing less than what Belshazzar did when he poured wine into them and drank in them. We are profaning the sanctuary, folks. It's an abomination. If we say that there is no sanctuary, could it be that we are sinning against the Holy Ghost? Because in Hebrews chapter 9, Paul says, the Holy Ghost thus signifying that the way into the holiest was not made manifest while the first tabernacle was still standing. Who was saying that? Who is promoting the sanctuary service? The Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost. The sanctuary service is a message from the Holy Ghost. So if we profane the sanctuary, who are we warring against? The Holy Ghost, folks. We are putting ourselves on the wrong side of the great controversy. Which number is being stamped on our foreheads right now as we speak? What characters are we developing right now? These are heart-searching questions. Many more characteristics of Belshazzar and Nebuchadnezzar are pointed out in Daniel to make sure we are not copying what they're doing. In Daniel 4:30, what does King Nebuchadnezzar say? Is this not the great city that I built with my own power and for my own glory? What about the intemperance, the irreverence of Belshazzar in Daniel 5? In contrast with the resolve and the temperance of Daniel in Daniel 1, he purposed in his heart not to defile himself with the king's meat. There are many more characteristics listed. If you will just study them, who knows? We may start reflecting them sooner or later. What characters are we developing? I think this is the most important part that we need to understand when we are studying prophecy. It's not so much about events and timelines. Those are just icing on the cake, folks. The most important part is the part that has to do with character building. That is meat. That's what we need. What characters are we developing? What will all the Bible studies do if we don't develop these characters that we need in order to stand in the time of trouble? Are there still areas in our lives where we are being deceived to transgress the law of God? Are we going to be part of the group who God will point to and say, here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus? If I ask you, what is your size? What is your size? And I'm not referring to shoe size or a shirt size or belt size. I'm referring to character size. Are you a size 6 or a size 7? It's a work in progress, isn't that right? That's the best answer. But how many of you believe that no matter where you are right now in your walk with God, no matter whether you have lain with the pots, that God will take you out from where you are and give you victory over your sin? Amen. If we have the faith of Jesus, which is believing that Jesus can amply, fully, and entirely save us from sin, I think we have what it takes. Will we be the people who will bring an end to the great controversy and prove God to be right? Yes, God's law is holy, just, and good and can be kept. Or are we going to live lives of disobedient and prove Satan to be true? See, I told you, the law of God cannot be kept. That's our choice. How about that for this afternoon?
Questions? Yes, would you like to close off with some, pray for us?
Let's pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for the army. Thank you so much for what Pastor Ivor Myers and his staff are doing, Lord, to bring your word to those who are hungering and thirsting for it. We thank you that there are people who are willing to do this work, Lord, at a great cost and sacrifice. And I just lift up these people before you now, Lord, to continue giving them strength and wisdom and all the resources they need so they can continue the work you have placed on their hearts. Thank you, Lord, that you have given us a lot of light. There is a flood of light, Lord, in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Thank you that there is food on our table while there is famine for the Word of God everywhere around us. Help us, Lord, in your love and mercy, gather bread, not only for ourselves, but for those who are hungering and thirsting for righteousness. Give us, Lord, a hunger and thirst for truth. Most of all, transform us in your love and mercy through the truth that you have imparted to us. May we continue growing in grace. Lord, sanctify us through the truth. Thy word is truth. Thank you for being so gracious and patient. Thank you, Lord, for this meeting. Bless the people that are here and those who could not come. Forgive us our sins. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Just one more.